الولايات لله الحق هو خير.
الحمد لله. We've been asked to talk about begging and the issue of hard work in Islam. Sometimes ago, just a while, maybe like 2 months ago or thereabouts, something happened not far away from us. Do we remember the building that collapsed? We remember that there was one young man who came out shortly after the building collapsed. And the young man was telling us how Allah saved him from being one of those who died in the building collapse. And he mentioned that the reason why, you know, he was not among those who would die in that collapsed building was that he went looking for a job, you know, and he had a meeting with the owner of that building who also died there. I think his Femi Oshibona or something like that. So he said this man asked him, after saying that he is qualified for the job, asked him which church he attends, and he said, no, I don't attend any church, I'm a Muslim. And he said, to cut the story short, he said, the man said, no, I can't work with a Muslim. So I'll be saying praise the Lord, and you'll be saying Alhamdulillah. No, I can't work with a Muslim. And he said, that is what the brother said. He said, the man said, this is the reason why, because of Islamic faith, that is why you Muslims don't make head in life. That is why you have not made head in life, because of your Islamic faith. Now, when the news came out, many people became emotional about it. Many people became emotional. And people even offered him job. But beyond the emotion, I think we need to ask ourselves the question. Is there anything in Islam that makes Muslim comfortable with poverty? Is there anything in Islam that actually does not allow Muslim to make headway in life? I think we need to ask that question. This question is very critical. If you look at, there's a hadith from the hadith in the collection of Al-Imam Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir." The world is the prison, sijnul mu'min, the prison for the believer, and the paradise for the disbelievers. And which means that this word, does it mean that this hadith is making Muslims to be comfortable with hard life? If you are living a very rough life, always recollect that it is in your prison. It happened that Imam, a Jew, came across Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah ta'ala. A Jew came across him and he said, "Your prophet tells you," and the Jew was a poor man. And Al-Imam Ibn Hajar was one of the scholars whom Allah blessed. He has some money. He's slightly well-to-do. So the Jew accosted him and said, "Your prophet said, Ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir. So how is it that you are rich, I am poor? We should actually switch role. I should be the one that is rich and you be the one that is poor, because you should be in your own, you know, prison, and I should be in Al-Jannah, in this dunya." And Al-Imam Ibn Hajar said, no, you don't understand this case. The matter is not like that. The matter is that if you compare what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for you of punishment waiting for you in the hereafter, whatever that you are suffering here is will be like you are in Al-Jannah. And in comparison to what Allah has also prepared for the believers in Al-Jannah in the hereafter, whatever I am enjoying now will be as if I am in prison. Even if I enjoy it now, I'm still in prison in comparison to what is waiting for me. So it is not, this hadith does not teach the Muslim to be comfortable with hard life and poverty in this dunya. So if this is the case, in the narration it is mentioned that the Jew eventually accepted Islam. Now, if we say that Islam is not responsible for the poverty of Muslims, if we say Islam is not responsible, why is it that there are so many Muslim beggars all around? Why is it that there are so many Muslim beggars all around? On my way here, people have stopped me to beg me for charity. And all of them, at least apparently, they are Muslims. So if you say there is nothing in Islam that makes a Muslim to be poor or not to make headway in life, why is it that there are so many poor Muslims? There are so many Muslim beggars. Now the question is there anything in Islam that makes a person become comfortable with poverty? The answer to that is no. If you look at the text and even the examples from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will realize that Islam does not teach us to be comfortable with poverty. Rather, it is because we have chosen to be lazy. We have chosen not to appreciate hard work because Islam does not teach us that. With regard to wealth, Islam has taught us certain lessons. The first thing, Islam taught us to appreciate and accept the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the provider, is the source of all rizq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا وَيَعْلَمُ مُسْتَقَرَّهَا وَمُسْتَوْدَعَهَا كُلُّ فِي كِتَابِ مُبِينَ. In Surah Hud, verse 6, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. There is no daba, there is no creature that lives on the surface of the earth except that its provision rests with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَعْلَمُ مُسْتَقَرَّهَا وَمُسْتَوْدَعَهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all well aware of places of their existence and where He has placed their food for them. كُلُّمْ فِي كِتَابِ مُبِينَ. Everything is in Allah's record. That is very clear. So the aqidah that Islam teaches us is to understand that all wealth and all provision rests with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are required to have this aqidah. Similarly, from the teaching of Al-Islam is for us to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives expanse of risk. يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَقْدِرُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives expanse of risk for whoever He wills. Sometimes He makes it straightened for others. So we have equal opportunity. In fact, we have a better opportunity to have for our risk to be expanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there is nothing that makes a Muslim specially not to be able to achieve and attain, expanded risk. And we all know this. There's no need to talk about this to so much length. I mean, we all know that the richest person in this country today is a Muslim. In the entire Africa is a Muslim. So we Muslims also have equal opportunity to become rich as any other human being. So there is nothing that prevents us from having a risk. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who decides and expands risk for whoever he wills. So there is nothing that stops us from seeking it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, Islam does not also make us to be convenient with poverty, to become poor. Islam does not teach us like that. In the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to beg Allah to protect him from poverty. If our example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to beg Allah, "Oh Allah, protect me from poverty," then why will a Muslim why will Muslim find poverty conducive for himself? It is recorded that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the hadith, he used to say, in his every after salawat, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say this dua: Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-kufr wal-faqr wa a'udhu bika min adhab al-qabr. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-kufr wal-faqr. Oh Allah, I seek your protection from kufr, disbelief, and faqr, and poverty. If the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam seek protection from poverty every salah, at least 5 times a day, then it means there is nothing in Islam that makes a person feel comfortable with poverty. Similarly, from the hadith of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also is recorded that he used to say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-kasal. Oh Allah, I seek your protection from being lazy. Wa'udhu bika wal-haram wal-ma'tham wal-maghram. From sinfulness, from indebtedness. See, all of these are indication that Islam does not teach us to find poverty and hard life convenient. We should work hard in order to ensure that we do something for ourselves and ensure that we change the situation that anybody may be finding themselves at any point in time. So this is what Islam teaches us. Islam teaches that we should not be find poverty convenient. This is the teaching of Al-Islam. So the question is, if from the teaching of Al-Islam is that poverty is not something that we should desire, the Luqman, the same Luqman whom we find his name in the Quran, he said while he was addressing his son, say, Ya Bunay, say, my son, inni dhuktul murra, I have tasted bitter things. I have not tasted anything more bitter than poverty. So these are the teachings of Al-Islam. Islam does not make us to find poverty convenient, and rather Islam teaches us not to so if Islam teaches us to hate poverty, why are there so many beggars? Does Islam allow us to beg? Does Islam allow us to beg? At least, apparently, the majority of those who are begging are Muslims. Is there anything in Islam that makes it easy or encourage Muslims to resort to begging? And if you look at the text, you also find that there is nothing in Islam like that. Rather, you will find something that is, you know, converse to that. For instance, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا ينبغي للمؤمن أن يذل نفسه. It is not permissible for a Muslim to humiliate himself. How is it ever possible for somebody who will beg and he will not humiliate himself? The very first thing that a person has to do to be able to ask somebody is that you have to humiliate yourself. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is not permissible for anyone to humiliate Islam. It is not permissible. La yanbaghi. It is not proper for a Muslim to humiliate himself. So don't humiliate yourself. Similarly, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the statement that is recorded from him, he said, مَا يَزَالُ رَجُلٌ يَسْأَلُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ يَوْمَ الْكِيَامَةِ لَيْسَ فِي وَجْهِهِ مُزَعَةُ لَحْمٍ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a person continue to subject himself to begging continuously. If you continue to beg like that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, since he has chosen to humiliate himself in this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will humiliate him in the hereafter. And he is going to come on the day of Qiyamah without any piece of flesh on his face, as a form of humiliation. This is what Islam has threatened anyone who resorts to begging, except the one who has a need to do so. And we are going to talk about what are the conditions that make a person to want to have to go and beg. Otherwise, under normal circumstances, a Muslim must never subject himself to begging. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is not permissible for a Muslim to humiliate himself. So, from this, it is clear that Islam does not allow Muslim to beg. The Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, مَنْ فَتَحَ بَابَ الْمَسْأَلَةِ فَتَحَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ بَابَ الْفَقْرِ. Anyone who opens the door of poverty, anyone who opens the door of begging, Allah will open the door of poverty for him. The more you open the door of begging, even professional begging, anytime, always asking. All the time, can I hold something? Can I hold something? At the slightest opportunity, we want to beg. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, anyone who opens the door of begging for himself, Allah fataha Allahu alayhi bab al-faqr. Allah will open for him the door of poverty. So you can understand, you can see that for many people who are beggar, their situation never changes. It does not change their situation. You will see somebody who had been begging since the time that you are a child. He has been begging, he has never stopped begging. There are people who are like that. It doesn't change their situation. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has made it clear, you cannot open the door of poverty, of begging for yourself, except that Allah will open the door of poverty for you. So Islam is not the one that teaches us to beg. Similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you find that in most cases, I have passed by a beggar very early in the morning, around 7 a.m. I passed by a beggar. I needed change, and I wanted to. I passed by, can you please change, you know, this money to me to a smaller denomination? So he said, he was just, that beggar apparently was a Muslim, was just opening, quote unquote, his shop that very morning, very early in the morning. So He has not sorted the money that he made yesterday. He has not sorted it out. Maybe he worked late, quote and unquote. So by the time he brought the money out, wallahi, the money that beggar brought, I don't have that money. The money he brought out, and he was selecting the lower denomination for me, I myself don't have that money. So this is a lot of the people who beg don't have a reason to do so, and they are only doing so because of their avarice, because of their what they call ojukoko, their avarice and wanting to make more money. But listen to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. The Rasul said, "Man sa'ala an-nasa amwalahum takathuran fa innama yas'alu jamra falyastaqil aw liyastakthir." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, anyone who asks people for their money, for their wealth, in order to gain more, want more, not because of a need. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what he is getting from them is like a firebrand. It's like a fire. Let him either get more or let him get little from them. It is fire that isn't good to be for him. So this hadith is recorded by Imam Muslim. So this is the teaching of Al-Islam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't ask people. إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. If you must ask, ask Allah. If you must ask, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide for you. وَإِذَا اسْتَعِنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. And if you must seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the teaching of Al-Islam. Islam does not teach us to beg. Rather, Islam teaches the Muslim to value hard work, to work hard and earn whatever it is. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, you will make money. Sometimes people will give you money. Sometimes you will see money, and from all the income, from all the money that you will ever get, the best of all your resources is the one that you work for. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma akala ahadun ta'ama qattun." There is no one who eats any food that is better than the food khayra min an ya'kula min amali yadihi. There is no food that is better than the food that you got from the work of your hand. You will not eat any better food than the food that comes from your own handwork. This is what Islam teaches us. So Islam does not make us comfortable with poverty. Islam rather teaches us to be hardworking. Islam does not say that a Muslim cannot be rich. Islam does not say that a Muslim cannot desire to be rich. Islam does not forbid that, because the fruit of working hard is to get more, and Islam encourages us to work hard in order to make more. And in this case, does it mean that Islam forbid begging mutlaqan? Absolutely no. Islam does not forbid begging absolutely. Islam has also made begging haram except in three circumstances. That is the only time when a person can actually beg. The first of those circumstances, as related from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is that such a person, anyone who has a reason to beg, because begging itself, you cannot accomplish it without sending a message. The force of the message that you are sending is that you are complaining against Allah. Those who beg, they are actually complaining against Allah. See what Allah has done for me. Please give me. Allah did not give me. So this is the first thing. This is why begging is not permissible for a Muslim to turn into a business. Similarly, like we said before, it involves humiliating oneself. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned, لَا يَنْبَغِي لِمُؤْمِنِ أَنْ يَذُلَّ نَفْسَهُ. It is not appropriate for a Muslim to humiliate himself. Similarly, from the thing that you or the messenger you are going to also be sending with your begging is that you will always make it inconvenient for those who you are asking. Sometimes it is not convenient for them as well to give. But sometimes when you persist, a lot of the time, I'm sure that you will have also experienced it. Those who beg, in those days, when a beggar comes to you and you tell him, Ali Badesa, the beggar will turn. He's no longer walking. If you tell a beggar, Ali Badesa, what that means is that Allah will bring, make you fortunate. Allah will bring opportunity for you to make money. Ali Badesa is a sign, it's a language that is supposed to be understood, that is satisfying enough. But it's no longer working for the beggars of today. When you say Ali Badesa, they continue to ask you. But this is not permissible in Islam. The one who rightfully be able to beg is first from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is the one who perhaps on account of loss of his resources. Anyone who has lost his resources and he does not have any means of livelihood, for such a person, yes, has a reason for him to beg. He has a reason for him to beg. Anyone who has what he is going to eat in a day and a night is outside the circle of those people who will rightfully be able to beg. If a person has what he's going to eat in a day and a night, then such a person does not have any right to beg. If he begs, then what he is begging for is jamra, it's fire. And it's going to be fire for him on the day of Qiyamah. The other person who would have a right to beg is one who takes responsibility for the affair of another person. For instance, in the case of somebody who takes up the responsibility to pay the debt of someone else, said, okay, I'm indebted, and the person who is his creditor is disturbing him, don't worry, his debt is on my neck, don't worry, you can come back. Don't ask him again, come and ask me. And if the person, maybe he has certain things that he's expecting, but it appears that the thing did not come the way he want, then such a person has a valid reason for him to beg. So anyone who is not in that circumstance does not have a reason for him to beg. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a hadith, man sa'ala wa 'indahu ma yughnihi, anyone who begs and he has what is sufficient for him, fa innahu yastakthiru minan nar. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, anyone who begs and he has enough, then what is adding more for himself is fire. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, Ya Rasulallah, what is the hadd of what is sufficient? How do we gauge what is sufficient? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what is sufficient is what is sufficient for him, an yakuna lahu shib'u yawmin wa layla. He has something that will satisfy him in a day and a night. If a person has something that satisfies him in a day and a night, then he does not have a reason to beg. So the point is, Islam does not allow a person to ask and to beg except he is in the situation that is either he is, you know, he does not have what he's going to eat that day for a day and a night. Then the moment he has what he's going to eat that day and the night, then he cannot beg. Many of those who are begging don't fulfill this condition. And the one who also has the right to beg is the one who, you know, whose property become destroyed. He has wealth, but an unfortunate incident happened to him and he lost his wealth and he does not have again. Then he has a reason to beg. And the one who takes over the responsibility of paying, repaying a loan on behalf of somebody, and it happens that he cannot eventually come up with it, for such a person, he has a reason to ask for assistance in order to help. So, if you look at all of these things, from the fact that the Prophet ﷺ used to ask Allah's protection from poverty, combine it with the fact that, you know, the Prophet ﷺ said, anyone who begs, he is humiliating himself and it's not permissible for him to humiliate himself. And that if he continues begging, he is going to appear on the day of judgment in a humiliating, you know, a posture, such that his face will have no flesh. And add to the fact that the Prophet ﷺ said, no one has the right to beg except that he falls within this category. Anyone who is not in those categories has no right to beg. Now the point is, so why are there so many beggars who are Muslim? Why are there so many Muslims who are poor? Why are we, you know, find it convenient? Why do we find poverty, you know, comfortable? Why? It appears so. The reason is not far-fetched. The reason is only because we have become lazy as both individuals and even a community. We are not as hardworking as we used to be. And I think that the reason also is that we always think that Islam does not encourage you to be rich. If you are rich, then it means that you are running after dunya. And that is not the case. The only thing that Islam mentioned to us is that don't allow your seeking for provision, seeking for money, don't let it become in the way of your worship. That is the only thing. Don't let your seeking for money, don't let it deny you of the primary, of fulfilling the primary obligation why Allah has sent you to this dunya. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent his messengers to this dunya. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us about them, Allah made them to be human beings who will go to the market and also make transactions. Allah said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَّا إِنَّهُمْ لَيَأْكُلُونَ الطَّعَامِ وَيَمْشُونَ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. We have not sent any messengers before you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except that they are messengers who ate food. Not only that, they are messengers who will walk in the market. They will walk in the market. They are human beings who will walk in the market. So the point is that our examples are that of the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were human beings. They were delivering the work of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they were still walking in the market. وَيَمْشُونَ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. They were walking in the marketplace. What will anybody go and do in the market? Is it that you go and buy or you go and sell? So if we have messengers of Allah who are also busy had businesses that they were doing. Then where are we getting our own example of not appreciating and not also, you know, encouraging the value of work and hard work? Where do we get that from? Because our examples are not like that. If you look at from the messengers of Allah, all of them, they were messengers who had their own calling, aside from the fact that they were delivering the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For instance, Al-Imam Ibn Qayyim, while mentioning the work of the messengers, so for instance, it is mentioned that the very first person, أول من خاط الثياب, the very first person who started sewing clothes, was Nabi Idris. Nabi Idris was the very first person who started sewing clothes. So he made sewing clothes his business, aside from the calling of delivering the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what you find is that the messengers of Allah, they succeeded in balancing between the worship as well as the work. They worked, but they also balanced it with the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the challenge that every one of us must face, and we must also make a success out of it. He also mentioned that the very first person, Nabi Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam, his own profession was hunting. He was a hunter. So this was his own profession. Similarly, Nabi Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, it was mentioned that he was a tabib. He was a doctor. He used to treat people. Similarly, Al-Imam Ibn Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, اعلم أن الأنبياء لما بعثوا داعين للخلق إلى الحق لم يطلبوا عن الخلق جزاء ولم يكن بد من الجريان مع الأسباب فاستدلوا كل منهم بالسبب. Each one of them, they were devoted to the means of obtaining rizq. They had their own work. These were the messengers of Allah. These are our models. So on account of that, it is important. It is not proper for any Muslim to say that, okay, I want to do the work of Afa, I will not be working. No, this is not Islam. This is not Islam. So every Muslim must have profession, must be professional. And Islam taught us that if you have professional, be professional in your profession. So this is what Islam has taught us, to hard work and also be serious in whatever you do. And if you look at our ulama, you know, look away from the messengers of Allah, look at the ulama, the scholars of Islam. You also see that many of them also had their own callings. They were serious. They didn't give the excuse of saying that, oh, we are worshipping Allah, so we are not running after dunya. They had work. So it is not proper for a Muslim to be one-sided. Okay, you are running after the dunya, then you are not paying attention to this. You are running after the hereafter. Yes, it's good that you should work for the hereafter. But you should, what about this dunya as well? What about your, if that is going to make you to become, to humiliate yourself and beg, you should be able to look away from what is in the hand of people. And the only way you'll be able to look away from the hand of people is you would. And wallahi, the only reason why many of those who are rich don't have any value for affairs is because you're always looking at what is in your hand. We went for a naming ceremony, myself and another brother. Then after the naming ceremony, the first thing they, of course, we didn't ask anybody for money. So one politician came, one big politician came around. And he said, have you, after you've done, you are finished, you are through with the whole thing. I said, well, there's nothing there to do. So we are done. Should I bring my own money? We didn't ask any money for anybody. If you want, you give. If you don't want to, he said, ah. He now said, ah, Mujeri, eh, Niko. So he dropped 50,000 naira. I look at my brother that we went together. We said, no way. We told him that, please take it out of your 59 away. We don't need it. So they started begging us. They started begging us. So I was only joking. No, you don't joke with things like that. No, I have many affairs that come to you. No, we will not come to your house. We will not come to your house. If you have affairs that come to your house and you think you could treat them with flippant, but the problem is that they will not be able to do that if there are not those who are already humiliating themselves because of it. And those who are humiliating themselves for those who are rich, is because they don't have anything that they are doing. If they have their work, then they will not subject them to humiliation from those who are rich. But unfortunately, this is not the teaching of an Islam. Islam does not teach us like that. Islam teaches us for a person to be industrious and to also ensure that they do whatever they do well. It is mentioned that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, up until the time that he became the Khalifa, he was selling clothing materials. He was a textile merchant. The same thing with Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. They were merchant in textile materials. These are our examples. They pay attention to their work and they obtain success in it. They didn't allow it to stand between them and their worship of Allah, so they obtained success of both this world and the hereafter. So this is our challenge. Similarly, it is also mentioned that Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, Amr ibn al-A'as, radiyallahu anhu, all of them were butchers. They said they were butchers. So this was their own job. So in this case, these are our salaf, these are our examples. They were people who had their own work and they paid attention to their work and they made a success of it. So where do we get the idea of becoming lazy and not, you know, seeking for means of livelihood? Don't forget, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, khairul kasbi kasbu yadil amil, the best of any is the one that a worker and work for. The best of any is the one that you work for. Either nasaha, when you become proficient in it. The best any is the one that you work for with your hand and in the work that you become proficient in. So for us as Muslims, other than even, you know, having work, another problem that we have is that we don't do the work professionally. We don't attain itqan, you know, in whatever we are doing. We have found so many examples. I have had so many people, you know, go to many of those Islamic schools, you call Muslim schools. They will tell you, they can't find good Muslim teachers. There are Muslim teachers, but they can't find good ones. So they end up employing those who are non-Muslims, even in Islamic schools. Sometimes you also find instances when people, they will complain to you that they can't find, you know, Muslims who are professional, who do the job. When you give them the job, they do it half-heartedly. They are only interested in what they will make out of it. Rather, they will not do the job well. So this is why we contribute to our own poverty. This is why we are not helping ourselves. Because we are not, yes, we learn trade, but we're not becoming professional in whatever we are doing. So this is our being. This is the reason why, you know, poverty is rampant amongst us. So it's not because there is anything in Islam that is actually making us to become poor. No. Islam has taught us and taught us well. But rather it is we who has not taken to the teaching of Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best food that you will eat is the one that you work for. The work that you do in which you are proficient in it. So it is important that we become proficient in whatever we do. And ensure that we are at the top of proficiency when they are asking in your trade, when they are asking for those who are the best. We should find Muslims there. We should be able to find Muslims who are at the top of every profession. Not to whenever they give us the job, then it's always complain all the time. We are not doing service to Islam. We are not doing service to the Muslim community when we do that. So wherever you are in your own small area, ensure that you are professional in whatever you are doing. So this is the teaching of Islam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Inna Allah yuhibbu idha 'amila ahadukum 'amalan an yutqira." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah loves that when any one of you does a work, you should do it well. It is a way of worshipping Allah. When you devote your time to obtain professionalism and you do it with sincere intention, you are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how you balance Allah. Allah has made Islam to be a balanced religion. So when a Muslim is like this, you know, he will attain, you know, professionalism, whatever he does, and he's at the same time, he's worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So on account of this, you can please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by also ensuring that you are doing what you are doing well. You can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by ensuring that you are doing it properly and to the best of your ability. Similarly, it is mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was supervising a janazah of a Muslim, and he was instructing them to dig the grave. And the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was saying, "Sawu lahdan hada, sawu lahdan, straighten the lahd, straighten the lahd." You know, they were digging the lahd is, you know, the grave that you dig, you know, a chamber towards the Qibla. So straighten it. The Prophet was instructing them to level it, make it smooth. It said the companions, you know, hatta dhanna an-nas annahu sunnah, until the people thought that straighten, making it smooth, is a sunnah. Because the Prophet was, you know, insisting that, you know, it is not straight enough, it is not smooth enough, smoothing it very well. They said that the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, was constantly instructing them to make sure that it's smooth, he said, after it, when the people became, you know, they were wondering, what is the need? Is it just a dead body we're going to put there now? It is a hole. The Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Amma inna hada la yanfa'u al-mayyita wa la yadurruhu, walakin Allah yuhibbu min al-'alimi idha 'amila an yuhsina." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "This instruction that I'm giving to you, smoothing it here, smoothing it there, it does not benefit the dead. It's not going to make the place more comfortable for the dead. Nor does it harm the dead. If it is not smooth, it does not harm the dead. But," he said, "وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ مِنَ الْعَامِلِ إِذَا عَمِلَ أَنْ يُحْسِنَ." That Allah loves that when a worker does a work, he should do it well. that when a person does anything, do it well. Wherever that needs to be adjusted, adjust it. Don't let anybody come and tell you that you should adjust this place. Don't let anybody come and tell you that you should do it, you didn't do it well like this. Islam teaches us to be professional in whatever we do. So this is from the teaching of Islam. And even if you are not going to do it, if you are not going to walk, because of the fact that Islam recommends that you should not humiliate yourself. Because if you don't walk, you will eventually humiliate yourself. You will eat what you are not supposed to eat. You will accept what you are not supposed to accept. Because you have not paid attention to the thing that you should pay attention to. But in this regard, if you don't do that, then you will not also be fulfilling your obligation as a Muslim. Because our obligation is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even with whatever it is that we consider to be our work. Similarly, it is mentioned that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, there's a companion, Khuzaymah ibn Thabit. Khuzaymah ibn Thabit is the companion that is referred to as Dhu Shahadatain. Dhu Shahadatain. He is the person that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said his shahada is the shahada of two persons. You know, if you want to get married, they said at least two witnesses should witness the marriage. If there is one of us that is there and there is no second person, then you know you do not fulfill the condition in that regard. But if Khuzaymah is present, he is alone. How did he earn this quality? Because the Prophet himself was the one who said that. It happened that the Prophet, you know, offered to buy an animal from a Bedouin. And when they already, you know, agreed, he said, okay, follow me so that when we get to a campaign, they already agreed the price. So when they were coming, the man was bringing the animal. Somebody, you know, met him and offered a higher price than that of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the man told, you want to offer something that this one is offer, or I should send it to them? We already agreed now. I didn't agree anything with you. The man changed immediately. So just afterwards, Khuzaymah came. And he said, what happened? And the Prophet ﷺ narrated what happened. He said, the man insisted that if you don't bring your witness, I'm going to sell this animal to another person. Where is your witness that will witness for you that I actually agreed with you on that term, on that price? And Khuzaymah was there. He said, I am your witness, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, how can you be a witness to something that you didn't see? You are not there. Yes, Allah has told us in the Quran that you will never tell lie. You will not say anything that is untrue. So I bear witness to you. And from that day, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the witness of Khuzaymah equals to the witness of two people. And this is why when Zayd ibn Thabit, when they were writing the Quran, the condition for writing the Quran down at that time was that every ayah they are going to write down. Zayd ibn Thabit knew the entire Quran of heart, but he didn't rely on his own, you know, memorization to write the Quran down. So anytime there's an ayah, there must be two people who will say, I had this ayah being recited directly from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If it is one person, they must look for one person more who will say, I had this ayah from them. They all know the ayah, but they will not write it down until two people witness it, until they got to one ayah. And They couldn't find any other person except Huzaima. Except Huzaima. He's the, all of them knew the ayah, but then it is Huzaima alone who said, I had it directly from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But they wrote it down. Why? Because his witness is equal to the witness of two people, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. But the point says that at his old age, when he became old, he had a farm and he abandoned the farm. So when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu met him, he said, why is it that you abandoned your farm? Why are you not farming anymore? Then Huzaima said, Ana Shaykhun Kabir, I am an old man. I'm going to die tomorrow. Why will I be busy myself to start, you know, running after any farm again? To start doing any business again? I'll probably die tomorrow. Then Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu said, he told him, no, don't do that. A'azim alayk. It is either you would go back and farm, because if you farm, whether you are going to be alive to eat it is immaterial. Even if you are not going to be alive, farm. Then Umar himself said, let's go together. Then they saw Umar and Huzaima, even Thabit, planting with their own hands. What do we gain from this author, from this narration? It is mentioned that a lot of the Muslim, when we probably think that, oh, we probably die tomorrow, why are we going to busy ourselves with work? This is not the way of the Salaf. The way of the Salaf is that whatever is there that is going to benefit, is going to bring benefit, whether to themselves or to some other people, they will go ahead and do the work. So let's not give any excuse of the fact that, oh, we don't want to run after the dunya. Because of that, we want to focus on worship alone. We don't want to. No, this is not the way of the Salaf. Rather, it is important that we pay attention to working, even if it does not eventually benefit us. At least some other people we take benefit from this. And as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned, "Ma min muslimin yadrusu gharsan." There is no Muslim who will plant any seed or any plant, or yazra'u zar'an, or he would cultivate any farm. فَيَأْقُلُ مِنْهُ طَيْرُ أَوْ إِنسَانُ أَوْ بَهِيمَةً, and any bird will eat from it, or human being will eat from it, or animal will eat from it, إِلَّا كَانَ لَهُ بِصَرَقَ, except that it is going to be a charity for such a person. So this is the consciousness, and this is the consciousness that Islam teaches us to bring towards, you know, whatever work that we do. Rather, so on account of this, it is important that we understand that Islam does not encourage us to beg. Rather, Islam encourages us to have work and to be professional in whatever we do, and also ensure that we benefit ourselves and benefit others. So we beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless whatever we do, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us our shortcomings. Wa sallallahu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.